And if you didn't get one down front, I'm going to be coming up the rows, and just let me know, raise your hand if you need one, because it includes some documents that Professor Merrell is going to be talking about in the lecture. It's my great honor and pleasure tonight to introduce Professor Merrell, who was born and raised in Minnesota and is the Lucy Maynard Salmon Professor of History and has taught at Vassar since 1984. He studied at Lawrence University and Oxford University before receiving his PhD from the Johns Hopkins University in 1982. Among numerous awards, he's been a fellow at the Newberry Center, the Newberry Library Center for the History of the American Indian in Chicago, and the Institute of Early American History and Culture in Williamsburg, Virginia. He's received fellowships from the American Council of Learned Societies, the John Simon Guggenheim Foundation, and the National Endowment for the Humanities. Professor Merrell's teaching and research interests are in early American history up to 1830, particularly the Indian experience in colonial times, and he teaches here classes on colonial America and the Revolution. His first book, The Indians' New World, Catawbas and Their Neighbors from European Contact Through the Era of Removal, published in 1989 by University of North Carolina Press, won the Frederick Jackson Turner Prize and the Merle Curdy Award from the Organization of American Historians, as well as the Bancroft Prize. His second book, Into the American Woods, Negotiators on the Pennsylvania Frontier, was published by Norton in 1999, and it was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, and it won Professor Merrell his second Bancroft Prize, making him one of only a handful of historians who've won that prestigious award twice. So please welcome Professor Merrell, who will speak this afternoon on A New Era in Female History, Women During the Revolutionary Era.
Thank you, Rebecca. You'll notice in all the things that she said about me, women's history, women, none of those things ever got mentioned. I want to start by saying I am not a specialist on women's history, and it's typical of Rebecca to so generously invite me to join you in this magnificent enterprise. She knows far more about women during this period than I do, but I appreciate the opportunity to come here today and talk with you a little bit about how I interpret women during the Revolutionary Era. I've handed out handing around a document that has three different parts to it. One is an outline of what I'm trying to accomplish, more or less. The second is the famous exchange between Abigail Adams and her husband John Adams, the Remember the Ladies exchange. And the third is a bibliography that, for those of you who wish to do further reading, indicates my debt to many historians of American women who have been working over the past generation to remember the ladies. So I do want to pay tribute to those women, especially the founding mothers of this of work on American women in this period, Mary Beth Norton and Linda Kerber, and also a more recent book by Rosemary Zagari. I've drawn heavily on these authors and the others on your list. I'm happy to be here for another reason as well, and that is the last two or three Thursdays, my time right about now has been devoted to trying to train my golden retriever puppy. And it's good for both of us, I think, that I take a break. Certainly for me. I don't know about for him. I thought briefly of bringing him tonight and having him sit here, since practicing the long down is something that we're supposed to work on. But it would probably be the shortest lecture in the series this fall, especially since his worst subject at the moment is meeting and greeting new friends. As some of you have experience with, he would soon be climbing into all of your laps. So probably it's just as well. It'd be definitely more entertaining, but perhaps not as edifying as what I'm going to be talking about today. I want you to take a look first at the document that I handed out, going to the source, as it were. I'm giving this to you for three reasons. The first reason is to emphasize the remember the ladies part of this, because I'm confining my considerations of women's experiences during the Revolutionary Era, broadly construed, to white women, mostly of the middling and upper orders. There is a rich and growing literature on women of color, Native American women, African American women, also poor white women. But for the most part today, I'm going to be talking largely about women of who would have been considered ladies, or at least aspiring to be ladies, in colonial and early national times. The second reason to give you this document is to set Remember the Ladies into context, because I think it's very revealing what Abigail is actually asking her husband to do. It is March of 1776. The British have just left Boston. They have been driven out by a clever move by General Washington and his army. Abigail is quite euphoric, and she's now thinking about independence. She has been pushing independence on her husband, and who is in Philadelphia with the Continental Congress. And now she is writing him, probably late at night, probably at the kitchen table, as Edith Gellis has suggested, to suggest that he remember the ladies. This, Edith Gellis and others have said, is perhaps the most famous phrase issued by an American woman, maybe before the 1848 Declaration of Sentiments from Seneca Falls. But in order to understand what she was saying, we need to look at the entire letter. This isn't just, remember the ladies, all men would be tyrants if they could, and going on to demand the vote, and demanding public office, and demanding various other things. In fact, scholars have been struck by, in some ways, how limited her request is. Woody Holton, who's written a Bancroft-winning biography of Abigail Adams recently, wants us to note that she's really only asking for laws against physical abuse of wives by their husbands, that she's not explicitly asking for anything more. And this gets us to the idea of the world that Abigail inhabited. It was not a world that she was trying in some modern feminist fashion to shatter. She's not thinking about political equality. She accepted the idea that women belonged in the domestic sphere and not in the public arena. She accepted the idea of separate spheres for men and women and of women's ultimate subordination to men. What she did not accept was the notion of tyranny within the marriage. So I give that to you just so that you can realize that we need to be careful taking 18th century terms and phrases and applying them to our own time, or seeing the roots of some modern movement that we all admire and support and follow, and finding them in Abigail Adams's letter. The third reason to bring this to your attention is because what's really interesting to me, and the launching point for this today, is John's reply. I cannot but laugh. It's not his scorn that engages me so much, although it is pretty striking. I cannot but laugh. He's been roundly attacked for that scorn and roundly punished ever since. It took a while for Abigail to write him back after she got his letter, for example. About a month. She wrote him three letters in March and zero in April. And when she did write him back, she said, I have not felt in a humor to entertain you. In other words, by writing you another letter. I have not felt in a humor to entertain you. If I had taken up my pen before now, perhaps some unbecoming invective might have fallen from it. Meanwhile, she is writing to her mutual friend. She and John both knew the Warrens. Mercy Otis Warren wrote to Mercy Otis Warren and said, I have found my husband's virtue wanting lately. He has written me a saucy letter. If he is not careful, you and I are going to petition Congress to get them to change their minds. The importance for me is not what Abigail responded when John wrote that letter to her. The importance is for what he says after that. I cannot but laugh. We have been told that our struggle has loosened the bands of government everywhere, that children and apprentices were disobedient, that schools and colleges were grown turbulent, that Indians slighted their guardians, and Negroes grew insolent to their masters. That's what I want us to start with tonight, because we need to see the American Revolution as a time of infinite possibility. Some people looked upon these possibilities with great hope. Other people looked upon these possibilities with great fear. But even in Adams's mind then, he laughs about it, but it's a hollow laugh. He is concerned that this society, if they break from the king, which has held them together since time out of mind, if they break from the king, can they just stop there? Or will everything else, if they cut the thread that binds them to King George III, will everything else come unraveled? They are contemplating treason in the spring of 1776. We think of this as patriotic behavior, and they're standing up for independence and for freedom and all those good things, and they were. But they were also committing treason. And they were unsure, the men in Congress, whether they also wanted to end up bringing forth a society that they did not anticipate and that they would not have been able to fully control. Remember, they grew up thinking their entire world was focused around the monarchy, the king and the queen, and British Parliament and the whole set of connections that had bound them to their mother country. What's going to happen if we pull that apart? This sense of plunging into an unknown future and perhaps into an abyss where Native Americans and African Americans and the lower orders and, yes, that tribe of women, this sense that the imperial crisis could get out of hand and to bring about a truly novus ordo seclorum, a truly new order for the ages, this was one of our founding fathers' greatest fears. We don't see that fear much today, that sense of possibility, looking back on it. We tend to think of the American Revolution as fairly tame. It's a bunch of gentlemen sitting around in lace cuffs and white wigs with those fancy knee breeches and linen stockings and the buckles on their shoes. They're sitting around in these drawing rooms drawing up declarations and constitutions. Oh, sure, there's a spot of bother with the British here and there, but ultimately, either through providence or fate or American marksmanship, Americans are destined to triumph. It is a revolution that is fairly tame, it is fairly bloodless, it is calm, it is reasoned, it is measured, and it is limited. That's not the way it looked to them at the time. That's not the way it was at the time. There was a sense of chaos, there was a sense of bitter invective and rivalry, there was certainly violence and bloodshed, and there was, yes, the nagging fear that the whole world would come apart at the seams and have to be stitched together again in a pattern that they neither knew nor could control. This idea that was put forth at the time of the contagion of liberty, how much farther will the contagion spread? Of course, what John Adams and other founders dreaded, others welcomed. And it's this sense of possibility and of opportunity, of everything being on the table, that we need to appreciate if we're to understand the experiences of women in this chapter of America's past. About if we're to understand what happened and what might have happened and what did not happen. As usual, Tom Paine, the author of Common Sense, best captured and celebrated the sense of unlimited possibility for reformation. "We have it in our power to begin the world again," Paine wrote in 1776. This incredible utopian feeling that it is a blank slate, we can start anew. He wrote at another point, "Our style and manner of thinking have undergone a revolution more extraordinary than the political revolution of this country. We see with other eyes, we hear with other ears, and think with other thoughts than those we formerly used. Every corner of the mind is swept of its cobwebs and poisons and dust." Paine was not the only one. He said it loudly, he said it eloquently, and he said it very well, and he said it early. But others picked up on this. A new era in female history comes from a woman, a Massachusetts woman named Judith Sargent Murray, who wrote in 1798 that "my fair countrywomen have seen the happy revolution which the few years past has made in their favor. The rights of women," she went on, "the rights of women begin to be understood. We seem at length determined to do justice to them." "Not only that," she continued, "I have confidence that more is coming. Our young women are forming a new era in female history." Other people saw that coming too. They were less enthusiastic than Judith Sargent Murray. A man writing at about the same time saw the same course of human events unfolding. But this was not his dream. This was his nightmare. This was not his hope. This was his deepest fear. He wrote as follows, "That revolutionary mania, which of late has so forcibly extended its deleterious effects to almost every subject, now includes women too," he wrote gloomily. "They seem to be seized with a revolutionary frenzy, to feel themselves highly wronged and oppressed. They seem ardently to wish for a revolution in their present situation." Again, the unraveling. The cusp, they seem to be at the dawn of a new era of female history. What was happening in America that the new nation, like it or not, seemed to be at the dawn of this new era? That prejudices and old ways of thinking had been shed and cast aside. Tom Paine talked about shedding our shackles, beginning the world over. To grasp that, let's take a look at women's rights and roles before Abigail Adams wrote to her husband in that spring of 1776 by looking at women in colonial times. And I'm doing this in very broad and almost crude brushstrokes, so I hope you'll forgive me, and especially the specialists in early American history will forgive me. Women in colonial times were idiots. Whenever I say this, I get similar looks on people's faces whenever I say this in my class. By idiots, I mean that they were private persons. They were not involved in public affairs. This was one of the original meanings in the Greek word, and this is what was used to describe women in colonial times. Legally, they were bound by a doctrine known as femme covert. Sir William Blackstone, the great English jurist of the 18th century, defined this very well. The very being or legal existence of the woman is suspended during the course of marriage, or at least is incorporated and consolidated into that of the husband, under whose wing, protection, and cover she performs everything. This notion of coverture, as a state court said in the early 19th century, using the term idiot more as we understand it, arises, as the state court put it, from want of agency in the wife as much as from the want of judgment in an idiot. What does this mean in practice? It means that a woman goes from the legal control of her father to that of her husband. Her domain is seen as strictly private, the home and the family, traveling alone, speaking in public, especially to what they called promiscuous audiences, which meant audiences of men and women, not promiscuous in the way that you might be thinking or others today would think of promiscuous. And they should not become too knowledgeable or too learned. They certainly legally cannot own property. If they earn wages outside the home in trade of some kind, they have to turn those wages legally over to the husband. They cannot sue in their own name. They are not allowed to write wills in their own name. This is a form of coverture. These views on women were grounded in more general assumptions about women's character and capacity. Rationality was seen as a key distinction between the sexes. Reason was widely considered a masculine quality. Eliza Pinckney, this amazing woman in South Carolina in the 18th century, who, because her mother had died when she was very young and her father had business elsewhere, was essentially running three plantations on her own. Instead of just saying, I'm a very accomplished woman, she wrote, I have a masculine mind. If you are capable, you have a masculine mind. A feminine mind, you didn't want to have one of those. Women, the feminine mind, women were considered vain and capricious, fickle and foolish, frivolous, extravagant. Their emotions overran their reason. They could not control their lowest instincts and lusts. The letters exchanged, the private letters exchanged between spouses in the 18th century suggest something of this disparity between men and women, even men and women who were married to one another. We all know about Abigail and John Adams writing My Dearest Friend to one another. They were not common in the 1760s and 70s when they first came together. Compare their exchanges of My Dearest Friend with how some of the Adams's contemporaries wrote to one another. The Iredells of North Carolina, for example, James Iredell was a fellow congressman with John Adams. He would write, My dear Hannah. She would reply, My dear Mr. Iredell. This is to her husband, remember, not her professor or something. My dear Mr. Iredell. Another wife wrote, My dearest husband, followed by, You will excuse the liberty of my addressing you as I have done. Too much affection. Too much familiarity, too much informality. Other men wrote to their wives, My dear child. Woman writes to her husband, How I miss you. He writes back, How you must miss me. You really want to sit that guy down and have a talk with him, don't you? But unfortunately, we can't do that. How you must miss me. Women tended to be consistently apologetic about their sex. You hear from the 18th century writings that those women who were literate penned a chorus of apology and lamentations over their limits. Elizabeth Graham Ferguson, a Philadelphia poet, petitioned Pennsylvania officials during the American Revolution and said, "Forgive me, any errors in this are due to the ignorance of a female." Mercy Otis Warren, Abigail and John's friend, in 1776, when he was away in Congress, he wrote to her to ask her views on what type of government should we set up. Adams was very interested in constitutions and went on and on about it, and he wrote to her asking for her advice. She was wary. I fear, she wrote back, that war, politics, or anything relative thereto are forbidden to women. Is your question designed to ridicule my sex for paying attention to political matters? Is this some kind of a trap that you're leading into? Reassured by his next letter, She replied that now she dares approach the verge of anything so far beyond the line of my sex. More generally, women time and again assumed the burden of negative female attributes. You know, we females are but weaker vessels. Many ideas occur to me, but alas, I cannot array them in my mind. My imbecility and weakness. These are all taken from women's letters to men, sometimes to each other, sometimes private, sometimes public. Now, some of this is a pose. Some of this is what women of great intelligence, like Elizabeth Graham Ferguson, and ability, like Elizabeth Graham Ferguson, who's an accomplished poet, would put forward when they needed something from men. They knew they couldn't just write them and say, hey, here's what you need to do and here's why you need to do it. They had to couch it behind this screen of self-abasement. But there's enough evidence in women's private letters to one another and in women's diaries to this same effect of a sense of their weakness and their inability, and perhaps, yes, their feminine mind. Given all of this, the political and cultural and customary bedrock assumptions about women's inadequacy and their inferiority, it would seem unlikely that when the imperial crisis came in the 1760s, women would have a role to play. And as we all know, no women were sitting in the Continental Congress with John Adams and Jefferson and the others. No women signed the Declaration of Independence. No women went over with Franklin and John Adams and others to negotiate the Treaty of Paris. No women were back in Independence Hall, as it's now known, drafting the Constitution through the long, hot summer of 1787. But that's not the whole story. If we define politics more broadly and more appropriately for the time, and this redefinition of politics, this more expansive definition of politics, that it's not just the legislative halls and it's not just the ballot box. This is a redefinition, by the way, that Rebecca Edwards has been one of the leaders in her book, Angels in the Machinery, in broadening and recognizing that political activity is not just confined to what we think of as politics. If we broaden it to include, as Rosemary Zaghari puts it, not only formal institutions of government, but also a wide variety of informal norms, symbolic actions, and everyday behaviors, then you begin to see women all over the place in the emerging imperial crisis. This was called out of doors, behavior in the streets, behavior beyond the confines of the home, or outside of the church, and so on. Women had a real role to play in the developing conflict between the colonies and the mother country. Those who opposed British taxation policies and other British policies in the 1760s and 70s had a number of weapons that they could use. They could write petitions, they could meet in congresses, they could write pamphlets, they could send Ben Franklin over to lobby on their behalf, as they did. But one of the most important of their weapons was the non-importation movement, the non-consumption movement. The way to bring Britain around to our way of thinking is to hit their pocketbooks. We are a major market for British merchants, and if we stop importing the many, many goods that we do import from Britain, everything from furnishings and furniture to clothes and tea sets, you name it, and they were importing it from Britain. If we can stop importing that, we will hurt them where they really feel it. Those merchants who have pals in the Parliament will go to their pals and we'll get this reversed. Non-importation is crucial. All of a sudden, how do you stop importing? Who's in charge of buying things in the colonial cities and countryside in the 1760s and 1770s? All of a sudden, women's household everyday behavior, which had been private, becomes political and even patriotic. Their contributions become part of the public realm. Nowhere was this more prominent than in spurning tea. Tea was a central part of colonial American culture, which they had adapted from the British. All ranks of society drank tea, and the middling and upper orders of society made a whole culture of the proper serving and the proper delivery of tea. You could even go to school and learn how to serve tea like a proper lady. And indeed, it was the hostess who oversaw the serving of tea. So all of a sudden, not serving tea is something that women, by refusing to do any more tea serving, are now stepping forward and making their voices heard in these non-importation movements. In other words, what we think of as simple commodities become politically charged and highly volatile. It now matters whether you are drinking tea or not. You can get in trouble for drinking it in some circles. You can get in trouble in other circles for not drinking it. This is women's first opportunity to have a true political voice. In 1770, a group of Boston women drew up an agreement against the drinking of foreign tea and got 125 young ladies to sign it. Another Boston subscription went around this town and got 410 mistresses of their respective families to do the same. Edenton, North Carolina, where they publish in the local newspaper their rationale for not importing and not drinking tea. Charleston, South Carolina in 1774, and on it goes. It wasn't just these kinds of public professions of their refusal. You could do this in all kinds of ways. We have the story of a young girl named Susan Boudinot of Pennsylvania, 9 years old. She was having tea with the governor of New Jersey, the royal governor of New Jersey, none other than Benjamin Franklin's illegitimate son. Wow, pretty fancy. This is a fancy tea. She, of course, as a young lady, this is her opportunity to shine in society, to show that even though she's nine, she truly is on the verge of adulthood and of being a properly genteel person. William Franklin, the governor, the royal governor of New Jersey, offers her the tea. She takes the cup and the saucer from him, raises it to her lips, looks around the room, walks over to the window, and chucks it out the window. That's what I think of your tea. My source doesn't tell me whether she chucked the teacup and the saucer. I hope so. Maybe she just dumped the tea. I'm not sure. There are more kinds of tea parties than the ones we hear about in the news today, and even the one that was in the Boston Harbor. Women published poems in newspapers expressing their displeasure. One particular foe was George Grenville, who was behind a lot of the British policies of this time. Here's one poem, which has stood for the ages, as I'm sure you'll agree that this is among the finest poetry ever written. "Stand firmly resolved and bid Grenville to see that rather than freedom we'll part with our tea." I kind of like that, it has a nice ring to it. Or here's one from Hannah Griffiths in Philadelphia. "For the sake of freedom's name, Since British wisdom scorns repealing, come, sacrifice to patriot fame and give up tea by way of healing." It's kind of nice, isn't it? It has a nice rhythm to it. They take oaths, public oaths in newspapers, renouncing marriage with men who will not oppose Great Britain. They say, "I'm not going to marry a guy who won't join the opposition. I'm not going to marry a guy who continues to drink tea." And if they are married, they publicly swear that they will convince their husbands and son to enlist in the cause or make life at home very difficult for them. There's another side to this as well. They're not just boycotting. I mean, if you stop importing British clothes, that's fine, but what are you going to do when your clothes get worn out? The homespun movement now also becomes a political action. And indeed, Laurel Thatcher Ulrich has counted about 46 different sewing bees and spinning bees in New England between 1768 and 1770, when the non-importation movement was at its peak. These were things where women would gather together in some public forum, like a minister's house or someplace else, would announce that they're doing this and would publicly proclaim their support for the opposition to Britain by making homespun clothes. This is where a young person who was involved in this said, "I carded 2 pounds of whole wool and felt nationally." This whole sense that, you know, I'm contributing by doing my everyday chores and duties. Also, of course, it becomes important what you're wearing. If you're wearing the latest fashions from London on the streets of Boston or New York or Poughkeepsie, you're risking trouble. If you're wearing homespun, you are making a declaration. We have a girl's diary from the 1770s. And she wrote, "As I am, as we say, a daughter of liberty, I choose to wear as much of our own manufactory as possible." She knows consciously that even at the age of 13, she is making a public statement. But if all else failed, if the poems and the resolutions and the boycotts and the homespun didn't convince people to join the cause of resisting Britain, women, like men, took to the streets to become a bit more coercive. Sometimes they helped out the men. We have evidence of they were going to do a tarring and feathering of a guy who wasn't behaving properly in his, he seemed to still be too loyal to the British and blindly loyal. So they were dragging him down the street for tarring and feathering, and a woman leans out the window and says, "Here, you need some feathers," and starts throwing her pillows out into the street for the guys to take down a little farther. But sometimes women acted on their own. In 1775, a Massachusetts woman named her infant son in honor of Thomas Gage. 1775. Thomas Gage was the military commander of Boston at that time. They had shut down the government, and so Thomas Gage was essentially a dictator. She names her kid Thomas Gage. A crowd of women who felt differently about General Gage attacked her house and tried to tar and feather not only her, but also her infant. As far as we know, they did not succeed, but they threatened. Abigail herself reported to John that same season that a crowd of more than 500 Boston women hounded a merchant who was hoarding coffee, waiting for the price to go up because nobody's drinking tea. While men stood by, Abigail wrote, amazed, silent spectators, these women grabbed the guy, threw him in a cart, seized the keys to his warehouse, confiscated his coffee, and the sources differ, perhaps even gave him a public spanking, like they were his mother and he was misbehaving. Was this sort of behavior confined to that cesspool of insurrection, Boston, Massachusetts? Absolutely not. Let's come closer to home. Fishkill, New York, just south of us. A guy is selling tea for what the market will bear. This is now smuggled tea. The break with Britain has happened. They are drinking tea again as long as they're not having to pay the duties on it. He's selling tea for an inflated price. They gathered to confront him. Three gentlemen passed by the house where this confrontation was being planned, and they asked these three gentlemen, please help us, here's what we're going to do. The gentlemen declined. So the women put the gentlemen in confinement so that they couldn't spread the alarm. They put them under guard, elected a committee of ladies to go to the merchant and march to the guy's store. He still refuses to lower the price. So they say, okay, they take him into custody, and then they grab the tea, measure it, sell it at a price they thought was fair, and sent the money to the local committee for resistance to crown measures. Right here in Poughkeepsie, and here I'm basing this on work done by one of my predecessors at Vassar, John Clark. He looked at Poughkeepsie. A Tory shopkeeper, apparently word hadn't gotten to him from Fishkill, I don't know what this guy was thinking, he decided to sell tea at a high price again. And the local women who thought this was unfair paid him a visit. As John Clark tells the story, they broke into the man's store, wrecked the place, drank all of his liquor, and apparently ended their day with a rock-throwing contest with the shopkeeper and his servants as their targets. They never did take his tea. They forgot about the tea. I guess they were just having so much fun. This is political action. I need hardly tell you. It's also political action of a certain purpose and with a certain limitation. They are upholding neighborliness. They are upholding the idea of a just price, of people doing right by their neighbors. They are acting alone, but they're often supported by the local rebel authorities, the male authorities. They are supporting what men are doing. But what happens when those men have to go off to Congress or off to war? What happens when independence is declared and they leave home for long stretches of time, as John Adams did, to make independence a reality, not just a declaration? Here is where some real change, and I think real possibility, begins to set in. And here's where I want to talk briefly about women in the Revolutionary War. I'm not going to talk about the famous women that some of you may have heard about Mary Hayes, otherwise known as Molly Pitcher, who manned a gun crew when her husband was injured in New Jersey, or Deborah Sampson Gannett, who disguised herself as a man and fought in the Revolutionary War and got a pension from the federal government. These are fascinating stories. I'm not going to talk about them. There's a whole book by Alfred Young about Deborah Sampson Gannett, if you're interested. I'm going to talk about the domestic management, about on the home front, about what women did when the husband went away. Now, you need to appreciate that many of these women, and the records suggest this, were fairly unprepared to run the farm or run the husband's businesses. They didn't seem to know what their husband's earnings were. They didn't seem to know what debts were outstanding, or even what property they owned. They had to learn fast, in other words, and they did. Abigail Adams is only the most famous of them. She found that responsibility provided her with opportunity. I find it necessary to be the directress of our husbandry, she wrote to John in 1776. I hope in time to have the reputation of being as good a farmer as my partner has of being a good statesman. They organized ladies' associations to support the war, starting in Philadelphia in 1780, raising money for the Patriot cause, going from door to door. They divided the city of Philadelphia into different districts. Women went door to door requesting funds for the cause, and they sent that money on to the army to support the army's troubled time in the early 1780s, we think, well, they just, you know, they declared their independence, and Britain is that nice little country, that little island over there, and it's very quaint and everything, but no worries. Britain was the most important and most powerful military in the world at this time, and it was a long and fraught battle, and 1780 was one of the many low points. These women are going out into the streets and are organizing to support this cause, and this spurred women in Annapolis, women in Trenton, New Jersey, and women in other towns around Philadelphia to do the same. These kinds of activities cumulatively instilled a new self-confidence in women. Women's work cannot be considered trivial now. Rachel Wells wrote, "I have done as much to carry on the war as many who now sit in government." In other words, you guys, you had it easy. I was out here by myself. They often became angry when husbands who were far away gave them advice. Here's Sally Cobb Payne writing to her husband. She pursued a debt case against his advice. He said, "Wait until I get home." She pursued the debt case, she took this guy to court, and she won the case, and she said, "If we had waited till you got home, we wouldn't have gotten any money out of this deal." Henry Knox's wife writes him, he writes her and says, "Have my brother sell these horses. I think we need the cash." So she tells the brother, sells the horses, he gets 75 pounds. She writes back to Henry Knox and says, "I could have gotten a lot more money than 75 pounds for that. I'm much better at this than your brother is. For now on, I want to be your agent. I am quite a woman of business," she reports. They also begin to discuss politics more than ever. If you've gone from thinking of yourself as not part of the family business, and there's a wonderful, very subtle change in language that I think it's Mary Beth Norton who has picked up on. You all know the guy, what's President Bartlett from West Wing? What's his name? Jedediah Bartlett? There really was a Josiah Bartlett in the Continental Congress. He was claiming that he was descended from this founding father. Well, there really was a founding father named Josiah Bartlett. We have their letters. In 1776, his wife Mary, he's off in Congress, she writes to him to talk about your farm. Your farm is doing very well this year. By 1778, she's saying our farm is doing very well this year. She has a sense of ownership that she didn't have before. And that gives her a sense, and others a sense, that they can step forward in a big way and begin to talk about politics. Some of them still say, "I don't know if I want to get too close to the edge of this boundary, but maybe I will." Eliza Wilkinson in 1782, a South Carolina woman who has stood up to the British when they invaded South Carolina, was tired of hearing that she shouldn't think and talk about politics. She wrote to one of her women friends, "The men say we have no business with politics. It is not in our sphere!" Exclamation mark. "I won't have it thought that because we are the weaker sex as to bodily strength, my dear, we are capable of nothing more than minding the dairy, visiting the poultry house, and all such domestic concerns. They won't even allow us the liberty of thought, and that is all I want." Time and again in women's letters of this period and during and after the revolution, you hear them talking about themselves as female politicians, great statesmen. Well, what comes with the peace? How is this society stitched back together again? As you can see from the outline, I want to argue first for a revolution, a new era in female history in important ways before I sort of reverse course a little bit. To some extent, and to a surprising degree, the high hopes that people had were realized, and real change for white women did result. There's new energy and a wider conversation about women's rights in politics and how much women can expect from this new American nation. There's a lot of talk of, you know, Britain oppressed America and we rebelled. Men oppress women, so .. Let's think about this a little bit more. This whole idea of revolting against the old order, against the old way of thinking and doing, is very powerfully part of what is going on, what is being exchanged in the newspapers and pamphlets and letters of the time. There's also political action by this new, more expansive definition that I was talking about, in which, mostly via print, masses are being mobilized in parades and festivals and commemorations to knit together this large and diverse land that America has become. These people still, Thomas Jefferson in the 1780s, said, when he says my country, he means Virginia in the 1780s. They've got a lot of work to do building a new nation and a sense of commonality. And these parades and pageants and orations, all of these things are designed to knit this country together. Women are incredibly important to this. Our happiness can be but half completed, said one man, addressing the women of his town, if you refuse to crown the whole with your kind approbation. And crown the whole they did, in all sorts of ways. On public occasions, women not only attended, but they sang patriotic songs that they had written, they played instruments, they performed in skits, they offered toasts to the new nation. In election time, they baked election cakes, as they were called. I've even had one. One of my students made me one a few years ago. It's pretty good, actually. I'm not sure, quite sure what makes an election cake. Another woman who's supporting her brother and hosts an ox roast at election time to support her brother. Not to be outdone, in 1802, the Republican women of Cheshire, Massachusetts, showed their support for President Thomas Jefferson by making the mammoth cheese. 1,200 pounds, 4 feet in diameter. The men delivered this to the White House on behalf of the women. Now, if that isn't politics, I don't know what is. Women also stood up at July 4th ceremonies and gave patriotic speeches. One woman in Vermont was elected orator of the day by her town and stood up and said, fellow citizens, addressing both men and women, and called herself among the representatives of the Confederated States of the Union. They also engage in political action by old definitions. They petition their governments to an unprecedented degree. Historians have found that in North and South Carolina, the number of petitions in the 20 years after the Revolution was 10 times as high as it had been in the years before. Women taking action and writing directly to their legislators asking for redress. 246 different women petitioned the U.S. Congress between 1789 and 1820. This, too, is a kind of political engagement. You must feel a certain amount of ownership if you are indeed petitioning. They're also voting. We have tended to forget that women in New Jersey, and New Jersey has a bad rap in our own day, so I always like to tell this story because women in New Jersey were voting. From 1776 to 1807, women who owned property in their own name, so widows, single women who owned property, who were not under the cover of the man, if they owned 50 pounds of personal property and were of age, they could vote, men or women. One traveler through New Jersey is at a tavern, and he sits down, it's near the election season, and he peruses a list of voters that was there. My eye ran over it, and I read to my astonishment the names of several women on the voting list. What? I said, do women vote here? Certainly was the answer, when they have real estate. Now, we can see this as a blip on the screen. Well, they weren't thinking straight in New Jersey. What do you expect from New Jersey? Put all of anybody's prejudices about New Jersey into the mix. But in fact, this was not a mistake. This was not because the men in New Jersey who drafted their state constitution in 1776 were thoughtless or careless. This was by design. It is the outer edge of the possibilities that were there in 1776 and beyond that Tom Paine is talking about. Why should it be gender that decides who votes? It should be property. So in New Jersey, not only could women who owned 50 pounds of property could vote, but so could African Americans who were free and owned that much property. This is much more important. And New Jersey men defended this. The rights of women are no longer strange sounds to an American ear, wrote one very conservative Federalist New Jersey man. I devoutly hope the day is not far distant when we shall find them dignifying in a distinguishing code the jurisprudence of several states of the Union. A male citizen on July 4th, 1800, gives a 4th of July speech. Our daughters are the same relations to us as our sons. We owe them the same duties. They are equally competent to their attainments. This is the part I love. The contrary idea that women are inferior, the contrary idea originated in the same abuse of power as monarchy and slavery. Those ideas are gone. They are part of the past. They are relics. And so is the idea that women should not be treated equally. The legislature in those 30 years in New Jersey did not receive a single petition demanding the disfranchisement of women. And Federalists and Republicans alike, as party politics grew in the new nation in the 1790s and became intense, making our own day seem positively tame by comparison, believe it or not, women recorded. In one New Jersey county, they were a quarter of the voters at one election before that was taken away from them. They even were caught stuffing ballot boxes. What could be more American than cheating at the polls? All of these women are to an unprecedented degree, to a degree their mothers and grandmothers couldn't have imagined, in the public life the public eye and the public conversation of the new nation. But that isn't the only reason we can think of the post-revolutionary decades as the dawn of a new era in female history. They were also, and I know this will shock and appall you, they were also reading novels. Yes, they were reading novels. It certainly appalled Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson thought that novels were very bad for women. He enjoyed novels, but women, you can't let women read novels. I'm drawing here on the work of a woman named Kathy Davidson, who's written an article and also a book. The article's called The Novel as Subversive Activity. The first American novel was published in 1789, the same year George Washington was inaugurated. Thereafter, hundreds of these novels pour forth. Many of these novels are written by women, about women, and for women. Many featured girls and young women in various adventures, dressing as men and fighting in the American Revolution, traveling to exotic corners of the continent or the world. Gothic novels of women fending off aggressive males and finding true love. These are read and read and reread. If you can't afford them, lending libraries arise in villages and towns across the country where for a modest annual fee, you can borrow books from the library and read them and read them. As I say, men were deeply disturbed by this. Women really can't be trusted with these books. Women should read sermons. They should read travel accounts by ministers or by other gentlemen. There is no mediating authority between a woman reader and the page. You don't have to know Latin and Greek to read these books. You don't have to really have a high level of education to read these books. Many of these books feature the wrong sorts of heroes, the lower class or women. There is a total immersion in these novels that these women get absorbed into them. It's almost like they're possessed when they read them. This is seen as very dangerous. Their emotions are going to get carried away. They're not strong enough to resist the pull of these novels. Of course, these fears were actually what was so attractive to women in reading these novels. These novels speak to young women in the new nation in ways that no other literature did. They're often about young women like them. They are often taking their concerns very seriously. They talk a lot about childhood. They talk a lot about courtship. They talk a lot about marriage and giving birth. And they also talk about the importance of speaking for yourself and thinking for yourself and getting an education so you're not tricked by evil and designing men. All of these kinds of things make the novel seem subversive and something that men can't control. We have the diary of a young woman in Boston who in 1812 writes that my parents kept bringing company over, many of them suitors, prospective mates for her, and she keeps sneaking upstairs to read the latest novel that she's gotten. She's leaving the family circle, she's leaving the courtship and moving into new realms. Speaking of which, courtship itself is changing. We have moved away from patriarchy where the father chooses your spouse for you, or it's an arrangement between families. Now, increasingly, it is seen as a matter of choice. This is not something that's peculiar to America. A lot of the things I'm talking about are not peculiar to America, but what I would argue is that the revolution gives them an urgency and gives them a political nature that you don't necessarily see in other societies. Now, courtship, advice books and magazines are telling women, courtship is a moment of your greatest power. You can now mold the taste, the manners, the conduct of your admirers according to your pleasure. You can change their tempers and dispositions. Seduce to virtue is the title of another one. The judicious management of love. Magazine articles, time and time again. The scheme for increasing the power of the fair sex. The power of beauty and the influence the fair sex might have on reforming the manners of the world. Seems a lot to ask for the dating scene in around 1800, but that's what they were saying, that you have great power at this moment. These men want you. They want to marry you. Here is where you can have tremendous influence over them. And indeed, we know that some of the young women of America took this to heart. This wasn't just advice from the magazines. Eliza Southgate, a Maine teenager, decides at first that marriage is not absolutely essential to my happiness. Don't need it, could live without it. Later, she chooses a husband, as she puts it, calculated to promote my happiness. Calculated to promote my happiness. This too is a new idea. And this is a phenomenon historians call companionate marriage, in which men and women are seen as much more equal than they had been before. I can't say that no husbands were writing back how you must miss me after 1776 or anything like that, but you do get a sense not just in the advice books, but also in the way people were arranging their marriages, that there is a sense of mutuality, mutual love, mutual friendship, mutual esteem. These are the terms that keep recurring. This too extends beyond the marriage to what scholars call republican motherhood or republican womanhood. Women now have a public role. Even if they don't go to the ballot box, even if they're not in some other way engaged in the public realm, republican motherhood gives them a crucial public role in the new nation. It is now their job to raise their children to be good republican citizens. The future of the country is now at stake. You're no longer subjects of the king. You are now citizens. You choose your own leaders. If you're going to choose wisely, you need to be raised properly. Those sons must know how to choose a man that they can trust with the public's wealth and the public's future. Those daughters themselves must be raised to, in turn, raise their own children to vote wisely and well. And of course, you can't do this without education. Here's where women's education, and this is another sign that you're seeing real changes in the aftermath of the revolution. Women's education becomes very much an issue of conversation. Women are no longer taught as Abigail was privately. Now you're getting the development of schools, primary schooling for girls and some higher schooling for girls. One scholar has found that more than 400 ladies' academies were founded in the decades after the American Revolution. Teaching various kinds of courses and various curricula, but all of them thinking that girls now need to be educated. Simply having them taught at home to one degree or another and leaving it up to their parents is not good enough for this new nation. As a result, the gap in literacy between men and women begins to narrow. In 1776, a little more than half of the white women in New England could read and write. By 1800, that percentage is now not just a little more than half, it's 90%. For Southern women, goes from about a third to more than half. All of this is both encouraged by and reflected in the explosion of newspapers and pamphlets and magazines that are written for women. The Ladies' Magazine and Repository of Entertaining Knowledge is one of the ones that's founded in the 1790s. These are pouring forth. Women are forming literary societies in which they sit down together and talk about books, and they're not just talking about the subversive novels I was mentioning. One of these literary societies in Connecticut is reading a two-volume history of the American Revolution by David Ramsey. I've read it. It's not easy. I'm impressed that they made this their book club reading list. You also get a shift in women's self-image now. Again, these things are very slow. They're very convoluted. It's not that women shed the shackles and no longer talk about their imbecility or their inability to think clearly or their inferiority to men, but you begin to get a rhetoric of female self-esteem, along with an argument that education can be a remedy for female inequality. You hear more talk about the excellency of our sex, of how women are rational beings and should develop a reverence of themselves, which is ever attendant upon self-approbation. The art of economic independence should be placed within women's grasp, writes one author, so that they don't have to be dependent upon their father or their brother or throw themselves at the first man who comes along to marry them so that they can stand on their own two feet. Women's own sense of themselves has changed. They are doing things that they hadn't thought possible before. And as you know, as a result of this, women were given the vote in the United States in 1820. It's really a remarkable story when you think about it. 1820, right after the Revolution, women get the vote. No, they didn't do that. I want everybody to be clear. It was 1920 when women got the vote. It wasn't 1820. I might be leading you to think that women got the vote in 1820 because, geez, it sounds like the shackles are being thrown off all over the place and women are moving strongly forward toward full equality, or at least the vote, if not full equality. That does not happen, as we know. It is a much longer time than that. There is something that David Bryan Davis calls the perishability of revolutionary time. It's a phrase that I like. I like it so much, I put it on your outline. The perishability of revolutionary time. And what Davis is arguing for there is this idea that during a revolution, there are moments when you really do have an opportunity to recast things at a very fundamental level. But those moments are short. That things happen afterwards, and that time, that opportunity, that sense of anything is possible is going to fade, the perishability of revolutionary time, and that is indeed what happens with American women in the post-revolutionary era. It's no accident that Rosemary Zaghari's fine book is entitled Revolutionary Backlash, that there is a turning against this. Remember that with Judith Sargent Murray talking about a new era of female history, there were others who were saying, this is the worst thing I can possibly imagine. A revolutionary frenzy that's going to include women? My God, this would be terrible. And you now find increasing voices in the public conversations of the early republic saying things like, the rights of women? That would be the wrongs of man. Female politicians? That is an amphibious animal. An amphibious animal. This is Judith Sargent Murray's husband writing to her about her own views of stretching herself out into politics. That makes you an amphibious animal. I don't think he meant it as a compliment. Women voting? The very idea is perfectly disgusting. What is next? Wrote one man, rather hysterically. What's next if we keep going in this direction? Will men reside and preside at the tea table? Will they then regulate the household and rule the nursery while all the offices of state and business pass into the hands of the ladies? This guy went so far as to say it's going to get to the point where the men are even becoming the wet nurses of the American Republic while women take over. I think this guy maybe was a little bit over the top, but this kind of idea that things are getting out of hand and we must somehow regain control leads to a rather different kind of development in the 19th century than Judith Sargent Murray had in mind in 1798. There are very few new legal codes. The doctrine of femme covert or coverture continues into the 19th century. New Jersey ends up being an aberration, not a harbinger of women going to the vote. In fact, the expansion of freedoms for men in the early 19th century, for white men in the early 19th century, the property requirements for voting drop in one state after another. One state after another is revisiting its constitutions written in the 1770s in the haste of war, and they are now explicitly saying only men can vote. They're making men more equal to one another by eliminating the property requirement, but now they're explicitly saying women cannot vote. Women's very lack of expansion is thrown into sharper relief by the sense that men of all ranks and all orders, doesn't matter their background, doesn't matter their income, doesn't matter their education, all of them are now considered equal in the political realm. There's also a shift in the political culture. Mass meetings and parades and these kinds of things give way to a tighter party discipline in which you're only interested in getting your guys to the polls. So now women's role is seen as quite otherwise. Women shouldn't get involved in politics because women tend to follow a particular party because they've got minds of their own, and party politics are getting out of hand. Women should step back from party politics. They should be a counterforce, a countervailing force to the politics that is trying to tear the country apart. There is concern about civil war coming to America as early as the late 1790s, when different political parties are raising militias and talking about marching on the nation's capital. We have to step back from this brink. Women can help us to do that. Don't let them get involved in politics anymore. Let them turn away from it and in turn turn their husbands away from it as well. What's interesting about this is that even the memory of these things begin to fade. It is around this time, the early 19th century, when people start to say, well, you know, the New Jersey thing was a mistake. It was a slip of the pen. They never really meant it. You also get women writing, you know, I remember when I was much younger, my mother and my aunts used to sit around talking politics. I can't imagine what they talked about. I didn't really understand it. And thank goodness things like that don't happen in my household. All of these things get sort of silently set aside and until historians have begun to dig them up in more recent times. Even supposed gains have another side. Companionate marriage. Okay, they tend to be more affectionate toward one another. There's a lot of talk about mutuality and mutual devotion and affection. Nonetheless, it's always clear who is in charge of these marriages. As Thomas Jefferson himself writes to his daughter, the happiness of your life depends now on continuing to please a single person. This is on the eve of her marriage. To this, all other objects must be secondary, even your love for me. Pleasing a single person. You have gone from your whole purpose as pleasing me to now pleasing your husband. It's no surprise that Jefferson, which we consider he considered one of our more radical founders, also wrote this: "The tender breasts of ladies were not formed for political convulsions." Women simply are innately unable to talk about these kinds of things. Education, too, does not lead women, as one scholar put it in 1793 at her school's commencement exercises, "We expect to gain entry into the church, the bar, the senate." It does not lead down that road. For many women, a few years of schooling led them to their highest calling, pleasant companions to good men, virtuous mothers of Republican sons. This was the be-all and end-all. And even then, the opposition to this educational opportunity was strong. Learning will make women unattractive, repulsive to men. It'll hurt, therefore, their marital chances. It will make them ill-suited for the role of wife and mother and domestic duties by putting ideas of a wider world into their heads. We have run into this before, and we will certainly run into it again this fall, I think, as the course moves along. The men wrote poems to this effect. "And why should girls be learned or wise? Books only serve to spoil their eyes. The studious eye but faintly twinkles, and reading paves the way to wrinkles. Let this be a lesson to all of us." "Women's brains," said another wise man, obviously thinking himself wise, I'm not sure we would agree, "women's brains are too small for thinking, but just big enough for love." Oh, yeah. Even Republican motherhood and Republican womanhood has real limits when you think about it. Yes, women have a public role, but how can they carry out that role? They can carry out that role by making their home, as they called it at the time and have since, a haven in a heartless world. It's becoming a cruel and competitive and individualistic and market-driven world out there beyond the home in early 19th century America. Women must be guardians of this, not just guardians of their sons and daughters, but guardians of their husband. The husband should be able to leave that world behind, close the door, and be brought into a realm of virtue and peace and kindness, and leave the competition and the double dealing and the dirty talk to others. This too, in other words, is confining people. Confining women in ways, even as it gives them supposedly a public role. So you do see this backlash, you do see this pulling away from the sort of society that Judith Sargent Murray, and maybe, yes, Abigail Adams too, was looking toward as things began to unfold and the country began to develop. But I don't want to leave you with that note. I want to leave you on a more hopeful note. The genie is out of the bottle, as one scholar has put it. The revolutionary era gave women a vocabulary of rights and the idea that they can talk about those rights. It gave women an opportunity to be educated. And as we all know, education can take people in surprising directions when their minds are opened to a wider world. Republican motherhood also not only gives these women education, it provides a springboard for women to move out into larger spheres of endeavor. Protect my family, protect my home. How can I do that when out in the wider world there are taverns that stop my husband on the way home and he drinks all of his wages away in alcohol, staggers home drunk and beats the children? How can I protect my family from that? Make my home safe? How can I do that when prostitution is rampant in our city? How can I do that when slavery spreads like a miasma across some pestilential pool, as Angelina Grimke put it, and corrupts the entire nation? We can't sit back in the home and protect the hearth. We can't hide behind the door waiting for our husband to stagger home from his business trip to the South, where who knows what has happened. From his trip, well, why is he late tonight? Maybe it's prostitutes and drink tonight. We must go out into the wider world and change that wider world. You say we have virtue. You say the power of virtue is real, that we can use that to change men in courtship and marriage. Fine. But we can't do that by staying at home. We must go out into the streets, and we must write, we must speak, we must petition, and we must march. This is not just do-gooding. This is not just an avocation. These women are getting together in collective groups, They are drawing up constitutions, holding elections, collecting dues, keeping the books, dispersing money, petitioning to be incorporated, buying property, and doing all kinds of things that, in the name of, we're just protecting the family, that launch them into that wider world very powerfully. They're saying we're doing this as an extension of our role in the family, not in violation of it. Even this feeling of being cooped up, of being excluded, gives women a phrase that you have probably heard before and will again. They often ended their letters to one another with this, thine in the bonds of womanhood. Thine in the bonds of womanhood. They meant bonds in two different ways, bondage and slavery. We are confined by womanhood, but also bonds that connect us one to another in our common situation, our common experience, our common plight. This sense of being subjected to restrictions and of collective power is a very real force in 19th, 20th, and 21st century America. So as the early republic moves into the deeper into the 19th century, what you have are a wide range across the country of talented, smart women who are accustomed to think for themselves, who are determined to get an education, who are determined to take that education out into the world to change it and make it a better place. Geez, smart and free-thinking women, determined to get an education, and with that education go out and change the world. Where have we heard of this before? Oh yeah, it's a place called Vassar College. Thank you, everybody. As I told Rebecca, my plan tonight, since I don't know anything about this subject, was to tell you everything I know and not leave enough time for questions, because I would just have to say, Rebecca, can you answer that one? Rebecca, can you answer that one? I am happy to entertain questions in the few minutes that remain, and even happier to stay as long as any of you want to talk with me. Are there any questions that people want to toss out in the 2 or 3 minutes that remain to us? Yes, sir. Yeah, the question is, were women taught as they were in 18th century France, were they taught in 18th and early 19th century America to be good spouses, to be good wives? The answer is yes and no. Does that help? Not at all. Yeah, some of the education was indeed for what we might consider ornamentals, sewing, music. If they were taught a language, it would be French. Abigail tried to get John to let Abigail and John's daughter learn Greek and Latin, but those were considered outside the sphere. However, as the post-revolutionary period emerges, you find more and more schools that are putting sciences in there, that are putting history in there, that are putting things that are not strictly designed to make them amiable companions to some man, that these are courses with some real rigor and with a purpose that is not simply to be a good wife. Okay. Yes?
I'm wondering if there are some figures like Anne Reed comes to mind, the leader of the Shakers, who violate all of this,
right,
kind of the ideal world is within the household and domesticity.
Yeah. Curiosities at best, Rebecca will correct me if I'm wrong, curiosities at best and pariahs at worst. There are certainly a lot of people are experimenting with various ways to break outside of conventional marriage and conventional relations between men and women. There are other utopian communities that experiment with this. There is a woman, Frances Wright, Fanny Wright, who has all kinds of strange ideas about the equality of the sexes and the equality of the races and goes around speaking about them in the 1820s and 30s in the United States. And she gets a lot of attention and also a lot of invective cast her way. She is seen as dangerous and crazy. So yes, there is a lot going on. People visit the Shakers. There's a lot of curiosity about them. But for the most part, they are mistrusted and seen as well outside the mainstream. One more question, Rose. A good question. They were not always, the question involves, were women the sole source of news? John Adams is down in Philadelphia. The British Army happens to be up in Boston at that time. And she certainly did give him information about the movements of the armies. But she was not the sole source of news. They had people going back and forth all the time that were conveying news that was more specifically military. She certainly added to that, but I don't see any sign of that. And I could be wrong, but I don't see any sign of that increasing her power somehow. I think if she were the sole source of news and there was something he needed to know, she would have gotten over her disappointment in his response and written to him for the good of the country. Thank you, everyone, for coming out today.
Thank you so much for coming, and thank you, Professor Merrell, for a wonderful lecture. If I can have everybody's attention for just 1 second, I hope you'll be back here next week. Professor Ron Packus is going to join me, and we're going to be talking about this new market economy that Professor Merrell was talking about. And we're also going to be looking at some of Vassar's own copies of Godey's Ladies' Book, one of the magazines or journals for all these newly literate women after the Revolution. So we'll have copies of Godey's Ladies' Books here from our collection at Vassar. So hope you can join us again next week. Thank you.